You're listening to The Hour of the Time, and I'm Pooh.
And I'm William Cooper.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, baby.
You're welcome.
And I'll see you later.
Okay.
Bye.
Bye. I'll see you later, alligator.
After a while, crocodile.
Bye.
Bye. How many times are we going to say bye, honey?
I don't know.
Well, that's about six, huh? Is that enough?
Yeah.
Okay, you want to say bye one more time?
Yeah.
Okay, hurry up.
Bye.
That's seven. Okay, folks, let me start off here. You know, I've been telling you for years, despite all the protestations of all of those who want to make an artificial, non-existent entity religious, it just ain't so. A government can no more be religious than a tree can be religious. A government doesn't go to church, doesn't adhere to doctrine. A government exists upon a piece of paper. In fact, the government of the United States of America exists within the document called the Constitution for the United States of America, and of course the first 10 amendments, known as the Bill of Rights. So, for somebody to make the ridiculous claim that the government is somehow religious, or the United States government is a Christian nation, it isn't true, ladies and gentlemen. Not true now, never has been true, never can be true. The government, as I said, is an artificial entity created in a contract called the Constitution for the United States of America. Nowhere in their document will you see any religion or any religious language whatsoever. You will see one clause forbidding Congress to pass any legislation recognizing an establishment of religion. Now, what do you think that means? That means the government of the United States is forbidden to recognize any religion, period. Doesn't matter what it is, including the Christian religion. You have to get over this, folks. Any government will reflect the religious beliefs of those who occupy the positions of power in the government. Those religious beliefs, those ethics, morals, will change if the religion of those occupying those positions of power changes. If tomorrow the entire upper echelon of the government were to be replaced with Buddhists, the government of the United States of America would slowly begin to reflect the religious beliefs of those people. And that's a fact. George Washington said so. And Congress ratified it. It was written in the Treaty of Tripoli, November the 4th, 1796. 8 statutes, 154 treaty series, 358 is a treaty of peace and friendship between the United States of America and the Bey and subjects of Tripoli of Barbary. And it's signed by George Washington and was ratified by the Congress on June 10th, 1795. Now listen very carefully. Article 11 of said treaty states the following, quote, as the government of the United States of America is not in any sense founded on the Christian religion, as it has in itself no character of enmity against the laws, religion, or tranquility of Muslimmen, and as the said states never have entered into any war or act of hostility against any Mohammedan nation, it is declared by the parties that no pretext arising from religious opinions shall ever produce an interruption of the harmony existing between the two countries. Let me read that again so you don't get confused because I mispronounced something. I'll just read that last portion after Mohammedan nation. It is declared by the parties that no pretext arising from religious opinions shall ever produce an interruption of the harmony existing between the two countries, end quote. That quotation, ladies and gentlemen, can be found in a volume entitled Treaties and Other International Treaties, 1776 to 1946, Volume 2, Philippines and United Arab Emirates, Department of State Publication, number 8728, February 1974, compiled by Charles L. Blevins, LLB, the Assistant Legal Advisor for the Department of State, for sale by the Superintendent of Documents, U.S. Government Printing Office, Washington, D.C., 20402. Listen to this. You know, I never saw this before, but it almost says exactly verbatim what I've been telling you. Quote, "The religion of national leaders characterizes the politics of the nation. The politics of the nation determines the degree of human liberty we have." End quote. End of argument. Except for the Looney Tunes who want to try to keep it going. And there's lots of them out there.
When you cast your eyes upon the skyline, to this, what's proud nation? This is India, a great trip, growing the hearts of its population. By the greedy hands of politics and half truths, the future generation, the future generation, of everything that misses the nation, the future generation, the future generation. Things about the gasoline fumes and hypnotized by the satellite engine, believing what it's giving, what it's right. Maybe worship from the temples of man, or lost in the prisons of religion. And you still walk back to happiness when you know where left to run. The future generation, the future generation.
Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to read you a communication from our station chief in Oklahoma, which was posted to the CAGI list on the internet. In answer to the advertisement, quote, "Exclusive interview with Tim McVeigh conducted at the prison. Only media bypass could gain access to Tim," end quote. I'm going to read a verbatim. I'm not going to interject anything in here because she does a good job. Quote, "This is not a true statement of fact. There are some issues which should be discussed publicly with regard to reports published by this magazine, if only for the sake of helping people understand that flag waving does not always equal truth telling. In late December 95, I had the exhausting honor of dining with Mr. Larry Myers of Media Bypass fame in company with James Nichols, Robert Nichols, Bob Popovich, Hoppy Heidelberg, Chuck and Feeney Allen, and Glenn Wilburn. During this lengthy dining experience, the topic of conversation was the Oklahoma City bombing investigation, in which all present are deeply and intimately involved. It has never ceased to be of supreme interest to me that Mr. Myers has never published any bombing-related article which has not ultimately aided the bad guys, while at times Not always. Mr. Meyer's facts have been accurate. It is important to carefully weigh his conclusions, which may or may not be related in any way to those factual disclosures. I mention this only to ask that readers of any publication, not just Media Bypass, use as much discernment and logic as possible when accepting as fact articles which pertain to the bombing investigation and which purport to be the truth. For example, many alarm bells sounded in my mind when the Media Bypass article about the federal grand jury appeared, and its content and conclusions had little to do with the reality of the situation here in Oklahoma. Following the publication of that article, and by way of obtaining confirmation or denial of its contents, I spent approximately 12 hours over a two-day period with Mr. Hoppy Heidelberg, taped many hours of statements made by him with his permission, and have reviewed the entire text, hundreds of pages of the transcripts of telephone conversations between Mr. Heidelberg and Mr. Larry Myers. It was allegedly these telephone conversations which were the basis for the Media Bypass article about the federal grand jury investigation into the Oklahoma City bombing. It is remarkable how dissimilar the article's contents and conclusions are from the actual statements made by Mr. Heidelberg. It is also revealing to note that at no time did Mr. Myers indicate to Mr. Heidelberg that he was interviewing him for the purpose of writing a magazine article, nor did he ask Mr. Heidelberg's permission to tape the extensive conversations, nor did he submit the text of the article to Mr. Heidelberg prior to publication for review, correction, or clarification, nor was any kind of signed release form obtained from Mr. Heidelberg. The final article contained misrepresentations, fabrications, twistings, and the removal of comments from context. The result of Mr. Meyer's disinformation, of course, was that Mr. Heidelberg was removed from the grand jury. Heidelberg was the only person serving who had any understanding of the rights and powers of the grand jury. He was also the only person serving who was pressing federal prosecutors to present all of the information pertaining to suspects, especially the witnesses who saw or had contact with John Doe No. 2, none of whom were allowed to testify before the grand jury. It is also very telling that at the time Myers was creating his destructive piece, the problems with the federal grand jury were not common knowledge. Mr. Heidelberg had been extremely discreet, was not making any public statements, and in fact did everything humanly possible to legally make known his concerns about the grand jury procedure to Judge Russell. All communications in this matter were conducted privately, in writing, between them because of the confidentiality requirements contained in the law. Mr. Myers' Media Bypass article served no purpose other than get the federal grand jury firmly back under the thumb of the federal prosecutors without any further dissent concerning the true rights and duties of the grand jurors. How convenient. It was only after Myers published his disinformation that the judge removed Mr. Heidelberg from the grand jury. After his removal, Mr. Heidelberg then went public with his concerns in an attempt to set the record straight, especially since Media Bypass had so inaccurately handled the matter. It was after Myers' article appeared that Heidelberg felt justified in making public his correspondence to Judge Russell and Russell's response, copies of which I have in my possession, and which I read verbatim over the air on the hour of the time on November the 1st, 1995. It was after Myers had done his damage that Mr. Heidelberg began to grant television and print media interviews responding to the Media Bypass fictionalized account of the situation. But if you don't live here in Oklahoma, you are probably not privy to that information. The bulk of it was never picked up by the national news syndicates. An occasional soundbite, yes. But the full story? Never. One has to seriously ask, because of the extreme caution employed by Mr. Heidelberg in handling his concerns about the grand jury, who told Mr. Myers about it? The contact between Media Bypass and Heidelberg was initiated by Myers, not Heidelberg. And Myers, according to Heidelberg, already seemed to know all about it. Another question worthy of consideration is, if Myers knew all about it, why didn't he publish the truth? There have been many instances when Myers has given indications that he is connected inside the investigation, but in alignment with federal prosecutors, not in alignment with anyone working to see that justice prevails. After all, no one has been convicted yet, have they? Of interest, too, is the fact that Myers mentioned before Christmas, 95, in the presence of seven witnesses other than myself, that the trial venue would be changed to Tulsa, a statement which is not yet fact, as the venue hearing is not scheduled until January the 30th, 1996. Interestingly enough, Judge Mesh did not express publicly that Tulsa was even being considered as a possible alternative trial location until after New Year's Day. While it is possible that Myers may have had some inside connection, feeding him prosecutorial information, one has to question the advisability of revealing this information in a public setting before so many other people involved in the independent investigations. Everyone at the dinner heard his statements, and I have them on tape. If Myers' inside source told him about the trial venue prior to the hearings on the matter, it must surely have been off the record, in which case Myers violated that trust. It must also be known that only the federal prosecutors are pushing for the Tulsa trial venue, no one else. As for the access to McVeigh claimed by Media Bypass, I spoke moments ago with the office of McVeigh's attorney, Stephen Jones, to determine the nature of any interview which Larry Myers may have had with McVeigh. Myers did obtain an, quote, off-the-record, end quote, interview of brief duration with McVeigh, during which no case-related matters were discussed. As logic should tell you, no public statements about the evidence, witnesses, the sequence of events, nor any other information vital to the defense presentation have been discussed at any time with any media representative with McVeigh. Mr. Jones is the official spokesman for all legal matters involving McVeigh, and he has declined all public comment about the details of those issues. Also, let it be publicly known that according to Mr. Jones's office, many, many media sources have obtained similar off-the-record interviews with McVeigh. They are not difficult to schedule. They are certainly not exclusive, and most of such conversations pertain only to basic biographical information. McVeigh is never interviewed by the press without legal representation present. The interviews are brief and are officially, and I'm going to say this again, quote, off the record, end quote. At no time are case-related matters discussed. It may be more accurate to say that Media Bypass is the only publication to violate the off-the-record confidentiality agreement, in the same way they screwed Hoppy Heidelberg and the Oklahoma grand jury. They are certainly far from being the only media source to obtain interviews with McVeigh. The claims of exclusivity are simply a sensationalistic advertising ploy to sell you more magazines. It remains to be seen what information or disinformation will be published this time. I will certainly withhold judgment in that matter until the Media Bypass article is publicly released. Maybe those of us in Oklahoma who are deeply and actively involved in this situation will be pleasantly surprised. The information contained here is in no way intended to slam that publication nor its writers. This notice is to list subscribers and contains nothing but statements of fact based in truth and documented on tape. Such easily confirmable facts can hardly constitute a slam. I really can't be responsible if the truth hurts. All I ask is that all parties interested in following the Oklahoma City bombing investigation be extremely cautious in your conclusions. Reserve your judgment until you really know what's going on here. The track record of media bypass is unfortunately not very good in this investigation, and its primary representative in this regard appears to be deeply connected to insider information originating with federal prosecutors, a situation which connotes bias and compromise. Do you really know who your enemies are? Read everything. Listen to everyone. Believe nothing until you can document it with your own research. And with regard to media bypass in the Oklahoma City bombing case, I have done that. My humble opinion is that Larry Myers' articles are brilliant concoctions of fact and fantasy which have done very little to further the cause of truth. And as such, they should be read with the following opening statement, quote, "Once upon a time," end quote. Bearing in mind that there will be no, quote, "happily ever after," end quote, when information is merely swallowed whole and never thoughtfully digested or researched by the public. Thank you for your attention in this regard. Major Michele Moore, Oklahoma City Station Chief, the Intelligence Service, Second Continental Army of the Republic. Off the record. Oh, me. I find it extremely interesting to sit back sometimes and just watch how the American people are so easily manipulated and how they are so hesitant and even hostile toward any personal research or investigation into the facts of whatever is presented to them. In fact, I was watching an interview last night, ladies and gentlemen, with the great liberal proponent from Crossfire. His name is Michael, and his last name has slipped my mind for the present, but it'll come to me. He was being interviewed. For once, he was the subject and had to listen carefully to questions and respond. He said that the American people are stupid and are easily led and manipulated to do whatever the leaders want them to do. I couldn't believe that he made that statement. But he did, right there on television. It was late at night. But it's absolutely the truth. He was just telling the truth. I wish more of them would tell the truth, but I wish they would tell it in prime time, because there were only a very few people up that late at night, and of all of the people up that late at night, there were probably five of us watching him being interviewed, because nobody really cares what he says most of the time, at least not that late at night. So, go figure, folks. I think it's going to be interesting. It's going to be at times a lot of fun and at times heartbreaking to see just exactly how the sheeple are led, by whom, into which shearing pens, and ultimately to what slaughterhouse. And I just can't wait to see what the Judas goat is going to look like. For there will be one, I can assure you. I love to do that every once in a while. Just stop and force you to think. And it generally works. In fact, at times when I've been lucky enough to watch an audience listening to a tape of mine that's been playing, when I do that, I can see them physically move forward. And the longer the pause, the closer to the radio they move in their seat. We'll go to the phones for the rest of this hour and see what all of you non-sheeple listeners to the Hour of the Time have to say. And sometime during this hour, I'm going to elaborate on an answer I gave a caller last week, because I'm sure he didn't get the proper message, because I'm sure I didn't communicate it properly. The number is 520-333-4578. Good evening, you're on the air.
Hello. Bill.
Yes?
Yeah, this is Derek in Rhode Island.
Derek, can you talk louder, please?
Yeah. In your opening Pledge of Allegiance, you have the phrase, one nation under God.
Yes.
Is this your separation of church and state?
Has nothing to do with me. That's the Pledge of Allegiance. Have you ever heard it before?
Well, it's on your program and it's being recited.
That's the Pledge of Allegiance.
It's the changed version. It's not the original.
How do you know that?
I've read it.
How do you know that? What is your source? What did you read?
I had to say it in school, and I remember it being changed in the 50s, mid-50s.
Well, can you send us the documentation and the sources that it's been changed?
I'm a witness.
Goodbye. Folks, if you want to contribute, contribute. Don't bullshit me. If you can't cite a source or come up with something or help us out, don't bother calling, because I'm not interested in hearing from you. If it has actually been changed, I want to know about it. If you want to help out by sending us that documentation, that would be wonderful. If you want to get on and sputter and stammer and claim you know something that you can't back up, forget it. We're not interested in that. If you want to be antagonistic about it, forget that too, because I'm not interested in that either. If you want to help, help. If you don't, take a powder. Good evening. You're on the air.
Good evening, Bill. Mike from Brigantine, New Jersey.
Hello, Mike.
Hi. I was just listening to what your station chief was talking about, the media bypass down there in Oklahoma.
Uh-huh.
And if I remember right, about a year ago on your show, you had interviewed someone from a magazine that you had particularly liked, and I don't remember it being Media Bypass. Do you remember offhand what magazine that was?
Could have been any. Could have been Backwoods Home. Could have been Perceptions.
Perceptions, that's it. I wanted to know, Bill, because I'm in the process right now of switching around a lot of my subscriptions due to exactly what you were talking about tonight with the whatever it is that's going on with the disinformation and the lies and the manipulation.
It's all over the place, and you have to be extremely careful.
And it's coming from some really surprising sources. I'm really surprised to hear that about Media Bypass.
Why are you surprised? The owner and the publisher came from Forbes. Do you know who Forbes is?
Yes, I do, and I didn't know that. Thank you for informing me.
So did Larry Myers, came directly from Forbes. Did you know that?
No, I did not, sir.
Do you believe that Forbes has an interest in the average American?
No, I do not.
Well, I can guarantee you they don't. But they do have an interest in bullshitting the average American to keep them from doing anything about what the people at Forbes want their future to be.
Absolutely, sir. I enjoy Veritas. That is one magazine that I will be keeping.
It's a newspaper.
Newspaper, I'm sorry. That's one I will be keeping, Bill.
Okay.
Okay? Yeah. Hey, well, thank you.
Okay, you're welcome. I can't help it, folks. 520-333-4578. Good evening, you're on the air.
Hey, Cooper, how you doing?
Good.
I'm Maryland.
How are you?
All right. I thought this might be of interest to you. There's a gal called into a show earlier tonight mentioning that there was an ad on page 13 of the current issue of The Economist, advertising for...
Can you speak louder, please?
There was an ad on page 13 of the current issue of The Economist.
Yes.
And I haven't seen this. I'm just repeating what I heard in the call. A lady said that they were advertising for a position in an international bank in the Philippines, and this person will specialize in involuntary resettlements.
Yeah?
To come elsewhere.
Well, it could be, but that kind of thing is not unusual in the Philippines, I can assure you.
Oh, I wasn't aware of it.
There are vast sections of the Philippines that are under communist guerrilla control, and they've been fighting war there forever.
Right. Well, I know that with me, the smaller outer islands in the Philippines, I think communists actually controlled those for quite a while, didn't they? Or probably still do.
Probably still do.
Yeah. Short comment with respect to the pledge. I seem to recall that there was a change in that too, but I'm not going to get into an argument over it.
Well, I absolutely know that there was. What I was trying to do is to see if that guy knew what he was talking about, if he was just full of bullshit. It turned out he was full of bullshit.
I don't remember what it was, but I remember there was a change, and I don't remember exactly when it happened.
Yeah, there was a change.
Yeah. Take care.
Under God was added to it.
Okay. Take care.
You take care, too.
She still sounds great.
She does sound great, and if she wants to say it the way she learned it, that's fine with me. I believe in liberty and freedom. I don't shove my ideas or my beliefs down anybody's throat. I try to awaken them so that they will know that they need to look for the truth and stop believing blindly whatever people tell them. I don't care what religion people believe. I don't care where they live. I don't care if they live in another nation. As long as they don't try to shove whatever they believe down my throat, I won't try to shove what I believe down their throat. But I will do my utmost to wake up the stupid, ignorant, apathetic, sheeple bullshit artists of this nation, I guarantee you, and hopefully the world, because if we go down, freedom for the whole world goes down, and that's a fact.
That's right.
Thank you for calling.
Take care.
You're listening to the Hour of the Time, and as usual, I'm still William Cooper. Brought to you by Swiss America Trading. Dealers in precious metals and all of the various forms. Real money. Legal and lawful money. Constitutional money. Not that counterfeit phony stuff in your pocket that isn't even what it pretends to be or says it is on the face of it. It's nothing but paper covered with ink. It's worthless. You can't even use it to take notes with because of all that ink and chicken scratches and stuff that it's got covering the face and back of it. Not only that, but if you look careful on the back side of the $1 bill, you'll see the symbol of those who are destroying this nation to try to bring about their one world socialist, totalitarian socialist government. I like what Anthony Hilder said on his record, and maybe we'll play that tomorrow night so that you can hear it again. And I'm not going to remind you what it is now because that'll ruin it for tomorrow night. We're headed for a fall, folks. This economy's got to come down. We're going into Marxist socialism. One of the goals was to eliminate the middle class. It's still the goal. there's going to be a redistribution of wealth. And they don't hide this whatsoever. That's one of the reasons for NAFTA and GATT, in case you haven't discovered it already. If you'd like to insulate yourself from this and at least protect a part of your assets from what is sure to come, ladies and gentlemen, I hope you will call Swiss America Trading right now. Tell them that you're a steady listener to the Hour of the Time with William Cooper. Ask them to send you the latest newsletter. And when you get it, read it from cover to cover. I guarantee you'll get red carpet treatment, and I know that you'll like the folks down there. They care about you. They have a buyback policy, which means that if you spend $20,000 buying their product, and all of a sudden the market drops down to where it's only worth $1, they'll buy it back from you at a pre-agreed price. You can't beat that. And you can't lose with a company like that. They guarantee what they do, and so do I. But just like happened last week, you know, if you feel that something's wrong, you call me, and I'll make sure that it is corrected immediately. I'll find out the truth, and I will make sure that if you have been treated improperly or cheated or lied to or anything else, it will be corrected. But don't even bother. If you wait, if you wait like that lady did, or actually it wasn't the lady, she didn't do anything wrong. It was her boyfriend who, in my estimation, probably wanted to get his hands on that money. So, call Swiss America Trading, 1-800-289-2646. Tell them that you appreciate the fact that they sponsored this broadcast. Do it now, 1-800-289-2646. You'll be glad that you did.
Leave it on the line. Alabama woman beamed aboard spacecraft. Give birth to alien life form.
Good evening. You're on the air.
Bill.
Yes.
Truck driver. Love your show.
Thank you.
What I want to know, where's Evergreen, Arizona on the population control series? I wrote you and asked you, but...
Evergreen is not too far from Phoenix. It's a central intelligence agency and other spook outfit place.
They got a lot of those, don't they?
Pardon?
They got a lot of those, don't they?
Yeah, they do. Too many.
I know it was their Miranda operation down there with the Air America and that. But is there any way to pull Hoppy's or get Hoppy's story in front of a grand jury, federal grand jury, or did they have jurisdiction there?
I have no idea. But what they did by dropping him from the grand jury because of what appeared in media bypass was wrong and illegal anyway. A grand jury is an autonomous body. It is outside the ruling of the judge or the prosecutor, but somehow the prosecutors and the judges have taken control of the grand jury process, and Hoppy Heidelberg knew the truth about the grand jury. And that's why they had to get rid of him, and I think that whole episode was done just to do that.
I see. What if another grand jury put the nose in that and didn't allow any interference?
Well,
would that help things out, or...
I have no idea. If you had a grand jury made up of all the members who understood the purpose and the autonomy of the grand jury and its authority, I think that they could really kick some butt. But where are you going to find them?
See that in the wind, Bill, because I think something's happening. But I've talked to Frank. I'd hope he'd talk to you, but as far as I'm sitting here on the phone, but
okay.
Been on worldwide radio before. So put a little scare in the sail, and let's roll on.
Good.
How's that?
good enough for me.
Radio.
Thanks for calling.
Yeah, talk to Frank, okay?
Okay.
We'll see, Bill.
520-333-4578 is the number. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, Bill.
Yeah.
You were talking about this internet that you've been working on. Can you give me the internet address so I can look that stuff up?
Look what stuff up?
Well, whatever you've got on your page. You read something.
It's not a page. We have a list. If you want to subscribe to the list, send a message to Major Domo. That's MajorDomo at PO Box.com.
At PO Box.com.
Yeah, PoBox.com. Major Domo at PO Box.com. And just put in the body of the message, subscribe, space, Kaji, CAJI, space, your address and your server.
Oh, okay. Well, that's good. I'm going to listen to you. You're doing well. I would like to hear some more about the secret religions of Utah and how they have been able to infiltrate the FBI, CIA, and Washington government. Yeah, I think people don't realize what a problem we are facing now with dual allegiances in our civilian intelligence service.
Well, what you have to understand is it's not just the religion in Utah. It is a secret brotherhood.
Well, we've had people here. We have a religion that swears a blood oath against the United States of America.
No, used to. They don't do that anymore.
Well, they now won't admit it, but they used to. Yes, they admit they used to.
Yeah, they used to, and all of the hierarchy of the church. And let's quit screwing around. I don't like this kind of talk. It's the Mormon Church, the hierarchy of the Mormon Church that is in office right now, took that oath during their younger years.
Yes. And certainly, I think you know that they have basically infiltrated the CIA and FBI. You know, there's a disproportionately high number.
Let me say this again. It is not the Mormon Church. It is a secret brotherhood of which many members of the Mormon Church belong. Do you understand that?
Well, I do. It's
not the Jews. It's not the Mormons. I know some Mormons who don't know a damn thing about what's going on any more than most of those stupid sheeple out there.
Well, you know that in Utah, they can't belong to the Masonic Order.
That's bullshit. That's baloney all through its history. The Mormon Church would build a temple and then they'd build a Masonic Lodge. So don't tell me that. I've studied them.
They're not accepted as members inside the state of Utah. They can't join a lodge in Utah. It's true. It's just, you know, outside of Utah they can. And probably many of them are members outside of Utah.
You don't understand. You haven't quite got the message. Do you understand the concept of a secret brotherhood that goes by many different names and many different occupations?
I believe I've listened to you long enough that I do, yes.
The Mormon Church and the Masonic Lodge are one and the same thing. If you've studied them, you should know that.
All I know is that there are sacred Masonic symbols that are supposed to be inside the temple, that are on the walls of the temple.
It's the exact same symbols. It's the ancient mystery religion. It's no secret.
Okay. Well, look, keep up the good work. You're coming in well tonight. Oh, by the way, one other quick thing. When people say you're being jammed, I've only heard one instance of somebody walking on your signal. All the rest of the time, these people are mistaken. It's just atmospheric. I have heard somebody broadcasting on the same...
Well, now, wait a minute. Okay. You're talking about in your area. In
yeah.
Some areas of the country, we are frequently and purposely jammed. In other areas of the country, we are not. And sometimes there's bad propagation, and it has nothing to do with anybody.
Well, I'm really familiar with the type of jamming that the military...
Let me say this again. In some parts of the country, depending upon what the subject of this broadcast is, we are intentionally and purposefully jammed.
How does it sound? Like somebody's broadcasting on your...
Folks, I'm not going to sit here and argue with you about these things. If you disagree with me, say you disagree. That's fine. If you want to argue, go somewhere else. I told you what I know. WWCR, some of the listeners of this broadcast who have radio direction finders, at one point traced the jamming to a Coast Guard station. WWCR can tell you about it if you want to know about it. Don't come on here and expect to argue with me. Once I tell you what I know, or what I believe, that's it. If you want to send me some documentation to prove something, that's fine. But I'm not going to argue with you on the air like a bunch of little kids on the playground. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello. How are you?
If you don't know by now, then I don't know what to tell you. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello.
Yes.
This is John from Vista.
Hello, John.
And I have a piece of information and also a question.
Go ahead.
Okay. If someone wants to simulate moon gravity, all they need is an inclined plane with an incline of 9.46 degrees. So there's one part rise to six parts run. That simulates 1/6 gravity. And the distance that you could roll a tennis ball or a bowling ball up that incline is the same distance that you could toss it up on the moon. That's how you simulate moon gravity. Perfectly so if you could eliminate the friction, which you can't totally. And
I don't understand how that would simulate moon gravity if you're going to be rolling it up the incline.
Well, that's a more complicated topic than we can discuss on the radio. I can mail some stuff to you about that.
Yeah, why don't you do that?
I will. And I have a question for you. One of your callers mentioned that Clinton asked you if Clinton was connected with the British Illuminati, and you said yes. And he said also you mentioned that Lord Rees-Mogg is connected with British intelligence.
Yes.
And your caller mentioned that Rees-Mogg was attacking Clinton. So can we assume from this that British intelligence is at odds with the British Illuminati, or is there something I'm missing here?
No, you're missing a lot. Clinton apparently has done something that has angered British intelligence. I have no idea what it is.
Mm-hmm. Is LaRouche at all on target as far as the things that LaRouche says?
LaRouche is a
angered British intelligence?
LaRouche is a communist, always has been.
Well, true, but is he at all on target in this analysis of Clinton versus the British?
He's for Clinton. LaRouche is solidly backs Clinton.
Correct. Okay, well, that answers my questions. Thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah, LaRouche is a communist. He solidly backs Clinton. He does have a good research organization called the Executive Intelligence Review, but you have to wade through the agenda and through the bias in order to be able to use what they give you. They give you good stuff. Good evening. You're on the air.
Bill, my name is Lee from Louisiana. How you doing?
Good.
I have some information for you, and I want to fax it to you. I know you sounded kind of interested in the pledge.
Yes. Actually, I already know all that stuff. I was just trying to find out what he knew.
Your audience?
Pardon?
Could I share this with the audience?
Sure, go ahead.
There's an extra thing that's interesting, too. You're right. Under God was added in 1954, an act of Congress. And I'll fax this to you. In 1923, the words, the flag of the United States of America, it used to be my flag of the United States of America, and it was changed to the flag.
That's correct.
Okay, thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Okay, good night.
Good night. Oh, well, that was illuminating for some of you. Good evening. You're on the air.
Good evening, Bill. This is Jim from Prescott.
I need you to talk louder, Jim.
Okay, how's that?
Your voice has to sound as loud as my voice sounds.
Okay. I want to talk about coalition of the third parties. But before I do, I'd like to tell you just a bit of advice. I've listened to you on satellite. If you back off that mic a little bit farther, you'd sound a lot better. You overmodulate. You sound like a Sunrod 55-4 speaker there in a dash.
Huh.
You get too close to that thing. When you turn your head to say goodbye to Annie, I mean to Pooh, or you holler at Annie or something, you sound a lot better.
Well, how's this sound?
Well, I'm not monitoring. I got the speaker down. But I'm sure you're calling.
They haven't fixed the everything was fine until they screwed around with the equipment at the uplink.
I understand. I heard it, as a matter of fact.
And I don't know what they did. They're supposed to fix it back to normal at some time in the future. I wish they'd hurry up, or I'm going to find another satellite because I'm tired of this.
Well, anyway.
I'm paying money to sound good, and if I'm not, then I don't like that.
Let's get back to the subject at hand here, the coalition of the third parties. Last summer, I believe you were having meetings about that.
Yeah.
And you came to some conclusions that they were all going to back one person this year?
Well, that's what it was supposed to be, yeah.
But you didn't come to a conclusion.
Pardon?
You didn't reach any conclusions, huh?
Are you talking about me or the group?
The group, yeah.
The group supposedly is going to back one candidate, but the group didn't consist of anybody except the Constitution Party and probably the American Party, and the rest of them were individuals there who claimed to represent parties or large groups of people, and come to find out they didn't represent anybody but themselves.
Well, I'd like to tell you that Charles Collins took his name off the Republican Party. He's going to run as an independent, and
doesn't matter how he runs. He hasn't got a prayer in hell of winning. I'm not telling you not to vote for him.
Well, all right, but
I'm just confronting you with the reality of the facts.
I can understand that, but
yeah.
Is there any other third party candidate that can do any better?
Let me tell you something. This nation is on a collision course with total and complete chaos.
Well, I can understand that, too, but...
Doesn't matter who you vote for.
Do we just sit down and give up, or...
I didn't tell you to sit down and give up. You have to do whatever gives you hope, but you have to understand that these people have decided with their wealth and their influence and their manipulation and their vast networks of people working against us that you're not going to win with the political process.
Okay, good night, Bill. Back off that mic a little bit and keep it back. You'll sound a lot better.
Thank you.
All right, bye.
You know, I'm not trying to put a damper on you. I'm not trying to tell you not to do it. I'm telling you the truth, and most of you know it in your heart, and you're going to find out it ultimately anyway. That's why Perot created his third party. It might be why certain people came together to create CURE. It might be why Charles Collins is running. Do you understand what I'm talking about? The first time I saw Charles Collins was at a CURE meeting. And at that meeting, when we asked him to present his platform to us, he didn't know what his platform was. He had to pull out a piece of paper, and sitting down, hunched over that piece of paper where we couldn't even see his face, he read his platform verbatim off that piece of paper. And I'm telling you right now, I knew right then and there something was wrong. Because a politician or somebody who pretends to be sincere or claims to be sincere knows his platform in his heart. In his heart. He doesn't have to read it from a piece of paper. Now, I've since seen him, and occasionally he reads from a piece of paper, and occasionally he doesn't. And his platform has changed quite a bit since the first time I heard him read it. So I'm not saying there's anything wrong with Charles Collins either. What I'm trying to tell you, folks, is you're being manipulated on a grand scale. A grand scale. And the votes in this country are so split up, and Americans themselves are so split up on things that they've been taught that are wrong about this country, and wrong about a lot of other things, that they couldn't even reach agreement if they had to. And that's the truth. It's like everybody knows government's too big. Everybody knows government spends too much money. Everybody wants their taxes cut. Try to do it and cut back on the services that affect somebody. Or take a shipyard out of a town. Or tell the elderly that, hey, you know, you should have saved a little money or gotten some kind of an insurance policy because we've got to cut back on this stuff that's costing so much money. Guess what? They'll slit your throat all the time, claiming that it has to be done. And you guys haven't figured that out yet. That's just amazing to me. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, good evening, Bill.
You need to talk louder.
Good evening, Bill. You're sounding pretty good tonight.
Thank you.
You're right on. And I'd like to say something to all these people that think they're going to go out and vote some change in this country. Ask themselves, how do they know that their vote is really being counted?
That's another thing. All these computer voting machines. Once you pull that lever or touch that screen or whatever, your vote turns into an electron, and you don't know who you voted for, and I can assure you of that. And on the presidential election, all the votes in this country go through a military computer before they are counted.
That's right. Bill, I have one question.
Not only that, but the paper trail has been eliminated in many states and many cities. They're coming out with just a computer voting machine, no paper punches, no paper ballot, and you don't even pull a lever anymore. You touch the screen. You touch the screen. You know, this is really funny, folks. I mean, if I was watching this on television, I'd be rolling on the floor. But it's not television. It's real life. We're out of time, my friend. Say whatever you got to say real quick.
It's scary.
Yeah.
Good night.
Good night. And good night to all of you out there listening, wherever you may be around the world. And remember, if you don't live in the United States of America, you better hope that we win this battle. Because if we lose our liberty and our freedom, you have lost your liberty and your freedom wherever you live, anywhere in this entire world. Good night. And God bless each and every single person who can hear my voice. And I think, there it is. Did you hear that loud noise? I thought a piece of equipment died, but it didn't.
Jones Center People's Temple was in reality a mass mind control experiment conducted by the CIA as a follow-up to something called MK Ultra.